again. This is Live at the Center, the show that asks the musical question. And behind me, we have the set for the show that's currently running, Monty Python Spamalot. But we're here to talk about the month of, what month are we talking about? The month of November.
November.
And a show that kicks us off in November is Little Shop of Horrors. Mm-hmm. And we have with us today the director and choreographer and the cast of Little Shop, some of the cast. This show opens on November 1, runs through the 17th. Tickets are $26, $24. Call our box office, 876-3080. Is that correct? Is that the number? Yes, 3080. And you can do that Tuesday through Saturday between the hours of noon and 5 p.m. You're going to go online, www.centerforperformingarts.org, 24 hours a day to buy tickets. So now tell me, this is based on a very little known play, The Little Shop Around the Corner. Is that correct?
You're close.
With Jimmy Stewart?
No. That's quite different. This was a Roger Corman B film.
A B film?
B film.
And what does B stand for?
Body.
No, it's like
not
the drive-in movie.
Right.
Yeah,
you know, sort of low budget.
Yeah.
Essentially.
And you're not in this. You're directing this.
Right. I'm not in this one. Correct.
And Fred, you're in this?
I am it.
And who are you playing?
I'm playing Mr. Mushnick, owner of Skid Row's Flower Shop.
Skid Row's Flower Shop. So even Skid Row has a flower shop.
Absolutely.
Who buys flowers on Skid Row?
Unfortunately, nobody.
Nobody.
That's the problem.
Is that the plot of the play, that you're not doing well?
We are not doing well, and I'm about to close, because I'm
shut down. Effectively shut down.
Done.
You know, we're no longer shut down, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to say. That's why we have this show today. So you're almost effectively shut down.
Yes.
All right. And this is Kate. Your last name is?
Weston.
Weston. Kate Weston. Who are you in the show?
I am playing Audrey.
At the plant.
No. Well, that's Audrey 2.
Oh, Audrey
I am
2.
Audrey the female.
The plant is named for you?
It is named after me.
It's named after
yes.
you. And have you done this role before? Is this the first time?
I have.
You
have?
This
is my second time doing it.
Where was the first time?
Golden Stone Productions.
Golden Stone. Where are they?
They are in Stone Ridge.
Oh, yeah, I know who they are. Yeah, right. When did you do that? Last year?
5 years ago.
Oh, it's 5 years ago.
And Charles.
Seems like only last year, though, doesn't it?
Yes.
To me, it does. Yeah, and you played the same role.
I did,
yeah.
And so did our plant. He was also the
Charles
Barnett.
Charles Barnett. Not Charlie, Charles.
Right, the
Charles
son is
Barnett.
Charles.
The third?
He's the third, and his son is
the fourth. And
makes
this is the first time at the center?
Name.
This is my first play at the center.
And what made you come here?
I've heard and seen a lot of productions here.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And that didn't keep you away?
No, it didn't. I love it, really. And I love this part. And
good.
So far, I'm loving the experience.
Yeah, and you sing a lot of big numbers. You have, like, one of my favorite songs in the whole world. Suddenly Seymour.
I was going to say, it's not closed for renovation, right?
No. Fabulous song. Fabulous song.
And also Somewhere That's Green, her solo.
Yeah, that's your fantasy about being married in a suburb.
Living in Levittown.
Yeah, living in Levittown.
Nothing fancy.
And this is Seymour. And your name is Charlie, and your last name? Charlie Bottom. And have you been here before?
No, this is my first time.
And what made you come here?
I am new to the area, and I was looking for a theater to call home. I grew up doing theater.
Do you have like a cot in the back?
You're
a real
the
theater
mess.
Kid?
Yeah.
What does that mean? You started at an early age?
My parents both did theater. I grew up doing theater since I was about six, I think.
What was your very first show?
I played a small Asian boy in King and I.
A small Asian boy in King and I. You know, we're doing Miss Saigon in the spring. So you might be a grown-up Asian boy. The way things are going, we're all going to be playing Asian boys.
Absolutely.
So this is Little Shop of Horrors. This was Roger Corman's super cult film, it says. So what came first, the musical or the film? The film.
Correct.
All right, so Roger Corman. And who was in that movie?
In the original?
Yeah.
Very early appearance by
Jack Nicholson.
That's the only one I know. He's the only one.
And now, if you look at the box now, it says on big letters, Jack Nicholson on top.
Yeah. Right. Wasn't he a co-producer?
He did a lot of stuff with Corman.
Yeah, he used to be one of Corman's co-producers.
They did Raven.
Yes,
also.
Right. He plays the dental patient who wants to have his teeth drilled. And, yes.
He does.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
There's also a little shout out to Roger Corman in the play also. At one point,
Who shouts out to Roger Corman?
I do. At one point, I'm kind of yelling to Audrey to don't forget to send those flowers, the Wolfbane, to Corman.
That's what that means. I didn't know that.
Okay,
so this is based on the Roger Corman super cult film, The play was first produced in 1982, and we're doing it here at the Center for Performing Arts at Rhinebeck, November 1 through 17. Shows are at 8 p.m. Friday and Saturday, always a Sunday matinee at 3 p.m. Tickets are $26, $24. Please call. You're going to need reservations. 876-3080. And you can call Tuesday through Saturday, correct? Between the hours of noon and 5 p.m. And always online, www.centerforperformingarts.org. Now, Lisa, you have done, this isn't your first directorial triumph. We know it's a triumph. It hasn't even opened.
That's right.
But this is
I like that vote of confidence.
I know. I'm always on your side. So like, this isn't your first triumph.
No.
How many shows have you directed?
Well, including all the kids' shows.
Everything. Must be
infinity.
30. Must be about 30 shows.
It's about 30 shows.
And you've been in about 111 shows.
At least.
Yes.
At
Were
least.
You really in the original production of Oedipus Rex?
I was.
That was in 483 BC, right?
BC. Yeah. How, look how well.
No, what roles have you played here? You've played some really big roles. You've been.
I wouldn't even know where to begin.
Well, Mama Rose and Gypsy.
Mama Rose and Gypsy, and Lady Mick.
Oh, the Lady Anne.
Lady Scottish
in
play.
In the Scottish play. Two I've diametrically done, opposed people.
Totally.
In
Oklahoma.
Ann Eller.
In Oklahoma.
Mama Morton in Chicago.
Yeah.
I've done the MC in Cabaret.
Yeah.
I've done Amanda Wingfield in Glass Menagerie.
Great production.
I play, yeah, because it was yours.
I know.
After all.
We're doing mutual homage.
The
MH Club.
The Canada.
Fred, so you've done like a bazillion things here too, right?
Yes, I have.
And your favorite role?
My favorite role has to be the Cowardly Lion.
I was just going to say.
I had the most fun with that part. It was a great production, great cast. It was just a great experience.
Yeah. Are you theatrically trained?
I am.
Yeah.
And right now I sing a lot. I sing with an 18-piece big band.
Wow, where?
In New Paltz.
Oh, yeah. What's the name of the band? You want to plug the band?
Big Blue Big Band.
And where can we see you and when?
Well, our next gig is at the Poughkeepsie Tennis Club on November 22nd.
You're going to be singing while you play? Is that how?
Yeah.
It's like mixed doubles with song?
It is. Yeah. It is. It's going to actually be a swing dance. So.
Oh, cool.
Swing
and where did you go to school?
I went to Wagner College.
Oh, Staten Island.
Yeah, Staten Island.
Yeah, my significant other graduated from Wagner. In the drama department, what year did you go there?
I went there 2003.
Yeah. When did she graduate?
Just shortly thereafter. No, prior.
Prior? 99, 90,
she's, 2000? Right.
Oh, Emily's like
so
5 years old.
They're 5 years old.
Yeah.
One.
She's only a day old, 28. And are you theatrically trained?
Yes.
And where did you go to school?
I went to school at Emerson College in Boston.
Great school.
For musical theater.
You did study musical theater.
Yes.
Yeah. And you got your MFA there.
BFA.
Oh, your BFA.
Yeah.
Yeah. And big roles? You play big roles?
Not a whole bunch of big roles, but a lot of supporting roles.
And before you came here, where were you?
I was in Maine.
And doing theater?
Before here, I was all over. I was in California for a while doing some soap operas.
Soap operas? Anything we've seen?
I was a regular in All My Children for 2.5 years while I was in L.A.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Was Phoebe still alive then?
I don't know.
Oh, well, she probably died.
Who's Phoebe?
Phoebe Tyler? Is that Phoebe Tyler?
She died long ago.
Huh? She died long ago?
Okay.
That was Ruth Warren, right?
Yeah.
Oh gosh, I never watched
Ruth Warren, who was Mrs. Kane.
You have to go back and look at your work, Charlie.
She wound up doing soap opera. I actually did a show with her in New York about 111 years ago. And so what else have you done?
That's your number of the day, 111.
It's because we're no longer shut down. And I can only deal in very simply 111. That's all I know for some reason.
It's got done it.
Totally. Yeah. So favorite role of all time?
Well, I played Seymour 20 years ago.
20 years ago?
In high school, yeah.
Yeah.
I've done played Joseph in Joseph, and that was a really fun role. Alfie Doolittle in My Fair Lady.
Oh, cool.
Also in high school.
Uh-huh.
And let's see. Harry Beaton in Brigadoon.
Brigadoon.
So a lot of musicals.
A lot of musicals.
Have you done like the classics, drama, Shakespeare, Chekhov?
Not much of that.
Who cares about that stuff anyway, right?
I grew up in a very musical theater
family. Who comes to see it? Nobody.
Nobody.
No. Well, actually, we're trying to change that. Yeah. And we'll talk about that in the second half of the show. And where'd you go to school? You went to?
Ithaca College.
Ithaca. That's where Ulysses went. right?
Right, that's where we had an affair.
Yes. Yeah. The King of Ithaca. I had a friend who graduated from Ithaca. And you have like a little lake or something? Is it a lake?
The Finger.
The Finger Lake. Every time they used to show up, she would always quote Kirk Douglas from that terrible Italian movie. Ship your oars. What else is coming up for you after Little Shop of Horrors?
Oh, well, I will be trying to fit into my ghost dress for the 10th year.
10th and last.
And last.
Oh, that's so sad.
Trapani's adaptation of A Christmas Carol.
You're all the ghosts.
Yes, I play all the ghosts, past, present, future.
You were alone last year, or did we have you
last year? I was with someone. I've had three men.
Three men. Dave Rodriguez, Rick Lang.
And Terry Weaver.
Terry Weaver. And then?
Then Jackie Capra.
Kate
Johnson.
Kate Johnson.
Lisa Lynn's alone.
Yeah.
Lisa Lynn's alone.
And last year, Carol Bogard?
Last year, Carol Bogard. Have we added it all up yet?
Yeah, now
Caitlin
this year.
McManaman.
You have Caitlin McManaman this year. We're going back to. Oh, they're giving me a signal. Heading for the last round. All right, so we're looking for you at Christmas Carol, 876-3080. You can buy a ticket for anything except Spider-Man, which is not at this theater.
It might be
someday. Little Shop of Horrors opens November 1, plays through the 17th, 8 p.m. Friday and Saturday. Is that 2 or 3 weeks? What are we doing? I forget.
Three.
It's a three-week show. Thank God. 9 performances. 8 p.m. Friday and Saturday, 3 p.m. Sunday matinee, which you'll never get into. It's always mobbed. All the senior citizens come on Sundays. Tickets, $26, $24. She's... Are you grimacing at the senior citizens? That'll be a long intermission. It always is. 876-3080. Reservations, Tuesday through Saturday. Call us. Call. You'll talk to the lovely Eileen. 876-3080, noon to 5. Or online, www.centerforperformingarts.org, 24 hours a day. And I think we're going to do some numbers from the show. Is that correct?
We are.
Two numbers from the show.
Yes.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back.
I deserve to creep like Oren Scrivello, DDS. Do you know where I met him? In the gutter.
The gutter?
The gutter. It's a nice spot. I used to work there when we weren't making much money. I'd put on cheap and tasteless outfits. Not nice ones like this, but low and nasty apparel. And I would...
Audrey, that's all behind you now. You got nothing to be ashamed of. You're a very nice person, and I always knew you were. Underneath those bruises and the handcuffs, you know what I saw? A girl I respected. I still do. Head, wash off your mascara. Here, take my Kleenex, wipe that lipstick away. Show me your face, clean as morning. I know things were bad, but now they're pretend.
Bushnick, and you should hear the way he talks to Audrey.
God in heaven will know the kid just said he'd mull it over.
No wonder she looks so unhealthy. That's enough to make you sick.
If he left me, if Seymour left me, why then I'd be right back where I started, which was broken, starving.
Good and sweet and beautiful as she deserves a prince, not a sadistic creep like him.
Close to bankrupt.
What a louse.
Beset, befuddled, and bereft. That's what I'd be if Seymour left.
He's a disgrace to the dental profession.
Seymour! Seymour!
Sir?
How would you like to be my son? How would you like to be my old adopted boy? I never liked him much before, but have the cash that's in the drawer. I've got no choice, I'm much too poor. Say yes.
What for?
Seymour, I want to be your dad. I want to see you climbing up my family tree. You can think you left the stench, but now I see that you're a match. Won't you be my son? Bushnick and son. Sounds great. Three words with the ring of fate. So say you live on the right with me. A florist's dream come true. Mushnick and his boy chick, you. What business will do for F.T.D.? How about it, Seymour, be my son? Say the word, I'll get my lawyer on the phone.
Now, Mr. Mushnick, don't be rash. You always said that I was trash.
Oh, I was joking.
There, I'm joking.
Expression of my pride, of the sweet paternal Michigas I've held pent up inside.
Gee.
So?
Well.
Well?
I?
You? And say it, Seymour, tell me that you will.
Gee, I'd really like to, but...
I'll hold my breath until...
Okay, okay, you win.
I'll be your son.
Hooray, I win, he'll be my son.
Drop the papers that I'm touched, I really am. And someday when you're 83, I'll let you come over with me.
You swear?
I promise.
What a son! Bushnick and son, that's that.
Officially, I'm your brat.
Consider the matter closed and done. Down to the world, let's stick. Our senior and junior shtick. Through thin and through thick. Through sloppy and slick.
So come kiss me quick.
Please don't make me sick.
And that was a couple of numbers from the Little Shop of Horrors, which is opening here on November 1st and playing through the 17th. And that was the lovely Joanne Schubert doing her unfinished symphony on the piano. Speaking of Little Shop of Horrors, the next big show in the month is actually something a little more serious. It's called the Naughty Bits Monologues. No, what is it really called?
That's the myth that Eve Ensler is trying to dispel.
Dispel the
by
myth.
By calling it the Vagina Monologues.
Vaginas.
Vagina.
Vagina, thank you. That's the name of the show, the Vagina Monologues. Mm-hmm. And promoting that show behind us, we have the set for Monty Python's Spamalot. I don't know why they have anything to do with each other. So this is a more serious show.
Yes.
This is the director, by the way, Tracy Carney. And this show is running three nights only, is that correct?
Correct.
22nd, 23rd, 24th of November here at the center. Did you pick this show?
Was it I did.
And why did you want to do a show called The Vagina Monologues?
Because.
Yes.
It dispels a lot of myths.
Okay.
It also gives an opportunity for women to express themselves.
Okay.
And it's funny.
Okay.
It's
so it is a comedy,
serious.
It's not all serious.
It's not all serious.
So it's like real life.
There are real life monologues.
Okay.
okay. that have been, that were real women who told their stories.
Okay.
And Eve Ensler did it as a one-woman show to begin with.
This is like how old now, 20 years?
1996.
So, yeah. 17 years. Okay, and we have three of the ladies who are
of
in the show.
Nine.
Three of the nine ladies yes. who are in the show.
Yes.
Now, when you say myth, I mean, there are no vaginas? It's like the
No, it's not
gold,
the myth of the vagina.
Like El Dorado?
It's the myth of what they're called.
Ah!
It's the myth of what they represent.
Okay.
And what they're capable of doing.
So next to me is Marlene Golia.
Yes.
And you're one of the ladies in this show.
I am one of the ladies in the show.
And I suppose you possess a vagina.
I do. Okay. That is a qualification.
A qualification.
Yes.
And so what do you say? What do you speak in this show? What is...
Well, actually, one of the monologues I deliver is from an older woman. It's her story.
Yeah.
And I also do another monologue from a six-year-old girl.
Okay.
And, you know, so it's all ages and all different. I think there were over 200 women who were interviewed.
To do this.
And then from that.
So this is real life dialogue. This is not like made up at Polkloff.
Mm, absolutely.
Okay, and this is Kat Barney sitting down to my far right, who is also in the show. And now, this is Anna. Your last name again?
Holder.
Anna Holder. Now, you're not all three in the same production.
No, Marlene and I are.
Marlene and Anna are together. There are nine women, so we're doing this three nights.
Mm-hmm.
So it's three different women per night.
Correct.
Okay, and so, like, you have a counterpart. On
Saturday night, and I'm
you open?
On Friday night.
So you're the Friday night.
Friday night.
And what night are you?
I'm Saturday with Rachel White and Jessalyn Kilgore.
Okay. And who's the third person with you guys?
Jerry Burns.
Jerry Burns, Friday night. You guys, Saturday night. Who's on Sunday?
Sunday is Claudia King, Susan Geis, and Shannon Malone.
So all of you, that's nine different women, and I'm sure each one of them has at least five friends. So they should all come to see the show. So what do you speak? What is your particular
Myth? I have
myth?
Several...
Yeah. Myth.
You said myth.
I have myth.
Myth? Myth? Yes. I have three different monologues that I'm doing. One of them is The Flood. It's an older woman. She tells a story of she was just beyond her time. She was too sexual for her time and just shut the whole system down. It's very touching story, and a lot of them are. They tend to have a little bit of emotion, a little bit of comedy to them. But I think what really brings people to see the vagina monologues is that they can relate in ways that they didn't even know that they could.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So this is more than a play about sexuality and a particular piece of anatomy. It's about oppression and liberation and
empowerment,
where you've been and where you're going. And what do you speak?
Well, I also have three different monologues, but my favorite is The Woman Who Liked to Make Vaginas Happy.
Okay.
So it was about a woman who was a corporate lawyer and turns to the fun side of dominatrix of women. So it's very interesting, and it culminates with a 5-minute long progression of various orgasms that she helps women achieve. So it's really kind of funny, and it speaks to everybody in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Have any of you done this before, or is this still the first time for all?
First time.
What made you come out to do this? I mean, they all auditioned, correct?
Yes.
All right, so what made you audition for this
Shop
of Horrors?
Well, that's a great show, too.
Right.
This is a real fantastic opportunity for actors and also just for women. I think a lot of people have heard of it over the years because it's done all over the place.
Right.
It's done at colleges, especially on V-Day, Valentine's Day. There's usually a big event. And I had seen it, I had read it, and I wanted to be a part of it for a long time, and it just was the perfect opportunity here at Brenda.
And why'd you come?
Well, similarly, I had heard about it, I had never seen it, but I read it, and I just fell in love with the stories that these women told, and the truth that comes out of each of these stories. There's a kernel of truth, and it speaks to me.
Mm-hmm. Is this your first time here?
It's my first time here.
Yeah, and?
I love it so far.
Yeah.
I saw Vagina Monologues when I was a sophomore in college at Syracuse University, and I loved it then, and so when I saw the opportunity to come out and audition, I really...
So there are no men in this play, I saw.
No.
How could there be?
But men should come see the
Absolutely, men should come and see it. And what will they learn?
There's no men bashing here.
No.
I think they'll learn a lot, actually. Yeah.
Like what?
Well, I think that they'll learn a lot that, that women have this kind of voice, this connection that we don't usually use. And I think that this show is really empowering in a way that uplifts all of society, not just women.
Mm-hmm. And there's no really, there's nothing really comparable to this that I can think of.
I don't think so.
No, I think it stands on its own.
Yeah.
And I think that's the brilliance of the writing.
Yeah.
And the vibrancy of the stories, because you'll come and you will find something about each of the stories that you can connect to,
And this is age appropriate, like, you know,
mature.
How mature? Like 12?
16, 17.
Because of language issues or because of what?
Language and subject matter. Some of them are fairly graphic.
Oh, really?
Violence.
And violent. Yeah.
Violent and what violence?
Yeah. Well, violence against women.
Domestic violence.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or war.
Tactic of war violence.
They mean the tactic of war violence. You mean like rape?
Yes.
Rape is a political terror tactic, things like that?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Okay. So 16 and up.
Yes. Yeah. Mature 16.
A mature 16. So this opens on November 22nd, and it's only 3 nights. It's actually 2 nights in 1 afternoon, 22nd, 23rd, 24th. Tickets are $20 and $18. And, you know, people always... Well, not always, but frequently criticize us, you know. Oh, look, Monty Python's Spamalot. Oh, Camelot. Oh, Little Shop of Horrors. Oh, South Pacific. Blah, 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 blah. Well, this is the stuff that we always do that you don't hear about or you don't come to, and I don't know why. But this is something you should see, and you know, we do serious work every year, and it's just stuff that nobody comes out for.
And I want to say, too, that and any of the performances that you choose to come to, the casts are equally vibrant. They're equally poignant. They're equally funny. They're equally personable. So not one night is stronger than another.
How did you go about doing the mix and the match? I'm curious.
The mix and the match came from, number one, calendar conflicts.
Who could do what and when?
Right. Number two came up with how I wanted to mix vocal qualities.
Sure.
And I knew that I wanted a mixed generational cast. I wanted a younger cast and I wanted an older cast. And thankfully, I got that at auditions and was able to mix that up.
How cool. That's really. And the reason for doing it that way was
points
what?
Of view.
Okay.
But life experience.
Do you anticipate that your Friday night crowd? So the Friday night crowd is the older women. Is that who the older women, or is that the mix?
That's the mix.
That's the mix. And who's the Saturday?
The Saturday are the younger.
And the Sunday is the older. Right, did you do that because you anticipated that the Sunday matinee crowd would be traditionally what it is here? Is
yes.
The older people.
That was partly.
And Saturday night is the younger people because that's when the kids
come. Yeah, partly. But it also, that really, the conflicts drove that train.
Right. Are you not doing, because sometimes this is done with a Q&A afterwards. Are you going to do anything like that?
We could.
You could, if people want to. I think that would be kind of interesting.
It's one thing that's really fascinating that I found is that the sequence of the monologues is brilliant. The way that they're put together, because there'll be something that's funny, and there'll be something that just is going to take your breath away because it's so horrible. But then it's followed up with something that's snappy, and where all three of us will talk at the same time.
And Eve Ensler did that. Yeah. You didn't do that. You didn't. It's ordered the way it
it's
is.
It's ordered the
that's
way that
scripted.
It is by Eve Ensler.
Uh-huh.
I have added a couple. Not added, but I have tweaked a couple of the monologues to work as the three women together that was traditionally done by one woman.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. All right, so Marlene, have you done things here before? This isn't your first show.
No, it's not my first show. I was this year I was in a reading of Awake and Sing, and then I was Fatata Tita in Shaw's Caesar and Cleopatra. And
Patata Tita, is that one of the euphemisms for...
No. It's close. There are some that are close to Patata
Yeah. See, are we like so much here? Maybe we'll run a little over. And what else have you done?
And then there's Highlights from the Footlights.
Right.
And I was in what was I in?
Why were you asking me? Like, I know.
I was in.
Well, you've done
Fiddler on the Roof.
Fiddler on the Roof. You also have done Little Night Music.
Little Night Music. Thank you. And Side by Side by Sondheim. Directed
by Lisa Lenz.
So it's all kinds of all singing, all dancing.
Yeah, and well, you did Highlights every year with Bernie,
Footlights,
who's your significant other, and also a very good piece of news: Marlene is the new president of the Center for Performing Arts. So we're very happy. We'll have her on board for, I hope, 2 terms. And Bernie is our treasurer. So that's great. Kat, so you've done a lot of things here.
I have. I was Magenta in Rocky Horror, directed by Lisa Lenz.
Great show.
Great show.
Why does she do those, like, scary movie horror?
Because she's cool.
Cool.
Because she knows that's the kind of stuff I want to do.
Yeah, so you did that. What else?
I was Maureen in Rent.
Yep.
I was Kate Monster and Lucy in Avenue Q. And
you were wonderful on that. My favorite is Drowsy Chaperone.
Oh, and Drowsy Chaperone. Yeah. Tricks, the AVA Tricks.
Yeah,
that was fantastic. Yeah,
lots of stuff.
A lot of great
stuff. Yeah.
Is this your first show with us?
It is my first show.
But are you theatrically, have you been in the theater before?
I dabble.
Dabble. What does that mean?
I did some work with the Paul Robeson Theater Company in Syracuse.
Uh-huh.
2000 through 2003, and then I moved to New York City and I did a bunch of film work, actually, which was fun. And then last year I came back to this stage with Karen Brody's Birth, which is really interesting and kind of translates well to vagina monologues because it's the experiences of women who've given birth in the United States and how they are treated or not treated and listened to and not listened to. So that's a really strong piece that kind of also drove my decision.
Yeah, aren't we like 23rd in the world in infant mortality?
It's pretty horrible.
Yeah, I mean, Botswana has a healthier birth rate.
Right, and less expensive, too.
Yeah,
so it's costly in terms of lives of mothers and babies. And
yeah, why is that?
Money. You know, there's a lot of theories. A lot of it comes down to defensive medicine and kind of the legalities of it, but we're a tinkering society. We always are trying to fix things and make it better. And in most cases, leaving a woman alone is the best.
Well, we've also put all the women's issues on the back burner, and eventually the women's issues, health and education, should be everybody's front burner issues, because if everybody's healthy and everybody's educated, then everybody's employed.
But you have to ask yourself why they do that.
Well, because the men are in charge.
Sweeping
generalization, 399 And there are no men in this show, are there?
No.
That's interesting. If we could find men with vaginas, they could be in the show.
No, actually.
Why not?
Because that's not what it... Okay. They don't have the same experience.
The
vaginas need to write their
own
script. After, what would we call that?
Men with vaginas monologue?
The Now I Have a Vagina monologue?
The vagina monologues.
The
All right, so here we are, November 22nd, 23rd, 24th, here at the Center for Performing Arts. The Vagina Monologues, directed by Tracy Carney, starring 9 incredibly talented and thoughtful women. This is a must-see. You absolutely must. I mean, I can't stress that enough. 876-3080, Tuesday through Saturday, between the hours of noon and 5. You can order a ticket from the lovely Eileen. You'll also go online, www.centerforperformingarts.org. And opening on November 30th, and we'll talk about it more next month, is Murder on the Nile, following up on the Vagina Monologues and Little Shop of Horrors. So thanks very much to everybody who's been here, Lisa Lenz and cast Little Shop of Horrors, Tracy Carney, and these wonderful women, Vagina Monologues, and yours truly, and Joanne's unfinished Schubert Symphony. Bye.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing, everything the traffic will allow. Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing that extra bite. and your dressing room, they hung a star. Let's go on with the show. The costumes, the scenery, the makeup, the props, the audience that lifts you when you're down. The headaches, the heartaches, the backaches, the flops, the sheriff who escorts you out of town. The opening when your heart beats like a drum. The closing when the customers don't come. There's no business like show business, like no business I know. You get word before the show has started that your favorite uncle died at dawn. And top of that, your partner have parted. You're brokenhearted, but you go on. There's no people like show people. They smile when they are low, even with a turkey that